How big is your God?
Huge, big.
Big enough to make a rock so big he can't lift up. You ever had anybody ask that? Can your God do anything? Well, yeah. Can your God, this is usually somebody who doesn't believe, right? An unbeliever, somebody who thinks that we're kind of crazy for trying to follow the Lord. Is your God so big he can create a rock so heavy that he can't pick up? Well, what's the response to that? Just kick him in the shin. Just pop him. There's no answer for that. He wouldn't, right? He can. If he can make a rock so big that he can't lift up, well, then he's not God because he can't lift it up, right? I mean, at some point, it's just kind of silliness. And asking a question like, how big is your God, is kind of silly, too, because it's not like God has size. It's not like God is taller than anyone or bigger than anyone. The Bible says that he is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. God is not flesh and bone, right? God is not corporeal. He's not physical. He's not flesh and blood. But the Bible talks about his strength. In fact, the Bible talks about his arm. The Bible talks about his mouth. The Bible talks about God's feathers. Oh, my stars. The Bible uses anthropomorphisms. That's a 25-cent word that means that to help us understand things that are beyond us, God reveals himself in with human-like characteristics, right? So when I ask a question like, how big is your God? Don't let me throw you off. For example, is your God bigger than your church? If you love what's going on in church, well, is that indicative of who God is? Not necessarily. I mean, is it possible to love church and hate God? Well, a lot of people do all over the world. They love their religion. They love how they serve and what they do and where they go, but they don't necessarily have a relationship with God. Is your God bigger than your church? Is your God bigger than your problems? Most people run to God when they're having a hard time, right? I mean, who hasn't prayed that foxhole prayer? You know, God, if you get me out of this, I'll do anything for you. God, help. And those are okay prayers so long as it doesn't just stay in the foxhole. Right? You climb out and you get close to God. You get close to God. But for a lot of people, they just want a God who's big enough to handle their problems. They want a santito to put on their dashboard. You know, they want a God that's just going to help them out when they're in trouble, not a God who's going to be the boss of their lives. God doesn't want us to be bigger than him. But then again, it's not really our choice. But we look at God in certain ways. We look at God like there's a connection to church, and there should be. We look at God like he's bigger than our problems, and of course he is. But if we're not careful, we're going to get a perspective of God that drives the way we live instead of letting God drive the way we live. Is God bigger than your universe? How big is our universe? Well, we believe that it's infinite. We believe that there's not an end. And if there is, it's not going to mess up my theology. But the Bible says that in the beginning God created nothing, and then he created something, right? In the beginning God created the heavens, and then he created the earth. And most of us kind of have an idea that God created a universe that was so immense, so big, that God can fit in his universe. Well, if you really stop and think about it, that's kind of like the opposite of, is God able to create a rock so big that he's unable to pick up? God is not in his creation. God transcends his creation. The Bible says that God measured the universe. He measured the heavens in the span of his hand, from here to here. And again, God doesn't have physical hands. But the idea is that the universe is not so big that God fits inside it. God is so amazing, he created the universe with its infinite beauty, its vastness and size and scope. Well, is the God you serve bigger than your church? Is the God you serve bigger than your problems? Is the God you serve having to take a back seat to the latest blech that you have to deal with? Is your God bigger than your universe? How big is your God? The Bible says in 1 Kings 8:27, Solomon was blessed by God, and Solomon was able to build a tabernacle, a temple, a huge edifice, a great place where people could come and see God and serve God. But will God really dwell on the earth? Solomon asked. The heavens, even the highest heaven, cannot contain you, Lord. How much less this measly little building that I built? It wasn't a measly building. It was a grand, huge, immense, beautiful temple, built according to God's specifications. And God wasn't able to fit in that box. God doesn't fit in a temple. God doesn't fit in his universe. God doesn't fit in your problem. God doesn't fit in this church. God transcends everything. Yes, God is here, but God is also there. Most people realize that God is probably there, but they don't realize that God is also here. God doesn't fit my paradigm. He doesn't fit your model. He doesn't fit mine. God doesn't fit in anything. He is the Lord God. Is your God bigger than your church, bigger than your problem, bigger than your universe? Is your God bigger than you? Who sits on the throne of your life? Who's the boss of you? Who calls the shots in your life? How do you decide what you have to decide? Do you run to Scripture or do you run to self? Now, we would never admit that we choose self over Scripture, but when you look at the path, when you look at the decision you're making and you look at the trajectory of your life and you look at how your decision is going to alter that, because that's why we make decisions. You look at where your life is going and you look at where your life is going to be going and you make these decisions. Well, is God bigger than the universe? Is God bigger than your church? Is God bigger than your problem? Is God bigger than you, or are you sitting as boss of your life? How big is your God? Check this out.
This is deeply theological. And the furniture starts creeping. I'll just laugh and say, hey, cut that out. And get back to my sleeping. Cause I know that God's the biggest and he's watching all the while. So when I get scared, I'll think of him and close my eyes and smile.
How big God
is. Will you fight them? No, not really.
Are you worried?
Not a bit. I know whatever's gonna happen, but God can handle it.
I'm sorry that I scared you when you saw me on TV.
Well, that's okay, because now I know that God is taking care of me.
That's how big God is. God is bigger than your church. God is bigger than your problem. God is bigger than you. God is bigger than the universe. God is bigger than the boogeyman. He's bigger than the monsters on TV. Why do we run from him? Why do we isolate ourselves from him? We don't think we are. We don't think we are. God warned us, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on the arm of the flesh, right? Don't lean on what you think is best. Don't rely on your common sense. Now, is God telling us to throw out common sense? Is God telling us not to use our heads? Well, of course not. Just don't limit yourself to what you think is best. Don't limit yourself to what you believe is the right path. There's a way that seems right to a man, the Bible says, but the end thereof is death. There's a path that God wants, and there's a path that the world wants for you. There's a path that the flesh wants for you. There's a path that Satan wants for you. What the world wants, what the flesh wants, what Satan wants is not the same as what God wants. How big is your God? Your perspective of God doesn't limit God, but your perspective of God will limit you. You're going to think you're okay when you're making decisions. You're going to think you're okay when you stop. You're going to think you're okay when you go. You're going to think you're okay when you do this. You're going to be okay when you do that. You want to constantly be reevaluating yourself. Constantly reevaluate. Second guessing? Nah. Constantly reevaluating. God, is this okay? God, is this all right? God, what do you think about this? How big is your God? Listen, there is no God greater than our God. You know that. But it's true, it's true, it's true. There is no God greater than our God. Yahweh, Adonai, Elohim, three primary names of God from the Old Testament. We've talked about this over the last couple of weeks. Yahweh, Jehovah. In your Bible, you'll find the word Lord every once in a while, all capitalized. Capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, Lord. Generally, when you find the word Lord in your Bible, all capitalized, it's translated from Yahweh or Jehovah, Yahovah. This is the name that God gave to Moses. I am that I am. I will be who I will be. I am Jehovah. This is what you're supposed to call me from generation to generation. Now, we know that he didn't just want us to call him Yahweh Jehovah, because he's given us hundreds of other names in the way he's revealed himself to us. But Yahweh Jehovah Lord, Adonai. Often in your Bible, you'll find the word Lord or Master, Sir. There you find Lord, capital L, little O, little R, little D. That is generally translated from the word Adonai. Adonai just means boss. It means master. It means sir. It means Lord. Elohim. A ton of times you find God in the Bible, G-O-D, God, means mighty one. It means elevated one, high one, God one, huh? Jehovah, Jehovah, Yahweh, Adonai, Elohim, God. These are the primary names for the Lord. Lord, let's go back to that. Jehovah, Yahweh, Lord, all caps. Over 6,000 times in the Old Testament, God revealed himself as I am, I am, I am, I am, I am. I am who I will be. I will be who I will be. I am who I am. I am Yahweh. I am Jehovah. 6,000 times over and over and over, he revealed himself personally. He didn't say, hi, I'm the pastor. He said, hey, I'm Tone. I'm Tony. Hi, how are you? He didn't reveal himself as the God who was there. He revealed himself as the God who is here. He's not just powerful, he's personal. He's not just Lord God, he's Lord God Jehovah. He's the powerful, majestic God whose name is I Am Jehovah. In the New Testament, he revealed himself as not just Jehovah, but Jesus. He gave us his personal name. You find Lord more than 6,000 times in the Old Testament. Exodus 3:15, God said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, Jehovah, Yahweh, all in caps, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Now, from what I said a while ago, Lord is all capitalized, right? So that's from Yahweh, Jehovah. The next one, God, you see that? God of your fathers, God of Abraham. What is that probably from? That's Elohim, Elohim. He sent me to you. This is my name forever. You shall call me that name, Yahovah, Jehovah. And listen, don't be scared to say the name Jehovah. Don't let the Jehovah's Witness take that away from you any more than the homosexuals took the word gay away from us. It's okay to be gay and festive. It sounds weird now. The word gay is okay. Don't let anybody take it away from you. Don't let Jehovah's Witnesses take the word Jehovah away from you. This is the name that God used to reveal himself over 6,000 times. I am who I am. I am Yahweh Jehovah. I'm not just out there watching over you and your problems. I'm right here in the middle of it because I love you and I care about you. Don't let the world, don't let the flesh, don't let the devil, don't let frustration, don't let foolishness, don't let anything pull you away from the path that I have for you. I am who I am, Moses. Call me this from just this generation forever. Lord, Adonai. Here you find some 200 times in the Old Testament. Lord, Master, Psalm 110, verse 1. The Lord, now what is that Lord? Go to the next one, guys. The Lord, all caps, is going to be Yahweh, right? Jehovah. You see, are you guys tracking with me? Am I making sense? Yeah, okay. This, yeah, helps. And he said unto my Lord, Lord, all caps, the second time? No, capital L and little O-R-D, that's probably from Adonai. The Lord God Jehovah said to my Lord, we find in other passages that the Lord God Jehovah is referring to, he's talking to his son, Jesus Christ. And Jehovah said to Jesus, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. You find that over 200 times. The next one, Elohim, he's God, the mighty one. The most frequent Hebrew word for God after Yahweh and Elohim. This one's used over 2,000 times, 2,500 times in the Old Testament. He's El. He's El Elyon. He's Elohim. He's El. He's the mighty one, the majestic one, right? He's the God, the judge, the mighty strong upper one, the in front one. Matthew 27:46. Jesus used a variation of this while hanging on the cross. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which is my God, why have you forsaken me? Where do you get God from that? Eli. Eli, El, El, Elyon, El, Loa, or Eloahim, plural. El is a mighty one. I am makes that Hebrew word plural. Elohim, Elohim. And from the cross, Jesus cried out, Elohim, Elohim. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? That's the God who's bigger than your problem. That's the God who's bigger than your pressure. That's the God who's greater than your frustration. That's the God who can keep you from foolishness. If you look to Him, if you lean on Him, don't throw out common sense. Just don't limit yourself to that. What is God up to? What is Jehovah doing? Who is Yahweh in your life right now? What is Eli, Eloi, El Elyon, Elohim? What is He doing in you now? He's bigger than everything. The Lord God is our Lord. He's bigger than any God. Look at Psalm 135. Follow along with me. You can turn to the Bible if you want. But Psalm 135, the Bible tells us that He is good. You know this, right? Let's kind of have a refresher course here. Psalm 135, verse 1. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. What is that first one? Next one, guys. Look at that. Praise the Lord. Is that all caps or just the first letters capitalized? So talk to me. What that word is probably what? Is that probably Elohim? Is that probably Adonai? Is that probably Jehovah? Loud enough so I can hear you. Adonai. Right? You see that? Praise the Lord. That's not His personal name. That's praise the mighty one. Praise the boss. Come to the God of your life. You're not the boss of you. He's the boss of you. I'm not the boss of you. He's not the boss of you. She's not the boss of you. They're not the boss of you. He is the boss of you. Adonai is the boss of you. Praise Adonai. Praise the name of Adonai. Praise Him, you servants of Adonai. You who minister in the house of the Lord. That would be me. And it should be you. I'm not the only pastor. You should be leading. You should be shepherds. I'm not the only servant. You should be serving. God has called anyone who serves in the house of God to praise the Master. Praise Adonai. Praise Adonai, you servants of the Lord. You who minister, you who serve in the house of Adonai, you who serve in the courts of the house of our Elohim. See, there's the third word for God. Praise Adonai, for Adonai is good. Sing praise to His name, for that is pleasant. God is good. Verse 3, praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. See how easy it is to put sermons together? I just have to see what the Bible says and then tell you. All I have to do is hold the mirror just right. So God's word is reflected out. That's how you preach a sermon. You know how you praise God? You take God's word and you turn the mirror of your heart. Hopefully it's pure enough, sinless enough, enough that when your life is the magnifying glass, is the mirror, you hold God's word up toward God. And He hears you praying His name. He hears you praising His words. He hears you wrapping your heart and your life and your hurt around His words. Guess how I get fed? God's word pointed toward me. How do I praise God? God's word pointed toward Him. How do I witness? God's word pointed toward you. If you're doing anything outside of that, you're just missing out. I'm just missing out. Common sense, yeah, but don't limit yourself to that. God has given us uncommon sense. Look for the path He's laid out for you. Look for what God is up to in your life. He's a good God. He's not going to hurt you. He's a great God. Psalm 135, verses 4 through 14. He's great. Verse 4. For the Lord Adonai has chosen Jacob to be His own. That's Israel. He's chosen Israel to be His treasured possession. 5. I know that Adonai is great. I know that our Lord is greater than all other Elohims. Adonai does whatever pleases Him in the heavens and on the earth, in the seas and in all their depths. He makes the clouds rise up from the ends of the earth. He makes the lightning come. He brings the rain. He brings out the wind from the storehouses. He struck down the firstborn of Egypt. He struck down the firstborn of Egypt and the firstborn of all the peoples and the animals. He sent His signs and wonders in the middle of your life. Egypt against Pharaoh and all of his servants. Verse 10. He struck down many nations and killed mighty kings. Sihon, king of the Amorites, Og, king of Bashan, and all the kings of Canaan. Verse 12, and he gave their land as an inheritance. He gave the land as an inheritance to the people of Israel. 13, your name, Adonai, endures forever. Your renown, Adonai, through all generations. 14, for the Lord Adonai, the master, the boss of you, will vindicate his people. You need vindication? You need somebody to stand for you? You want God to stand for you. Nice if I stand with you and say, hey, I vouch for him. I'll stand with her. Like that's going to impress anybody. But when the Lord God, creator of heaven and earth, when Adonai, Elohim, Jehovah, stands and says, I will stand with you. I will stand with him. I will stand with her. He's not only a good God, he's a great God. He's powerful enough. A couple of weeks ago, we looked at him as El Shaddai. El Shaddai is not only the God who's personal, he's the God who's powerful, and he'll outmaneuver, out-wrestle, overpower anything to get you what you need. He'll turn over heaven and earth, if that's what it takes. He'll send his son from heaven to live for you, to die for you, to be raised up from the dead for you. El Shaddai will do anything it takes to overpower the natural course of things to make it happen for you. But it's not all about you. God doesn't want us to be looking at him like the goody guy. He doesn't want us to look to him like Santa Claus. He's not the genie, you rub the lamp. But he wants you to know that that's who he is. He is Adonai. He is El Elyon. He is Elohim. He is, hi, how you doing? My name is Yahweh, Jehovah, Jesus. And he will have compassion on his servants. He's not only good and great, but the Bible says here in 135, he's God. Look at this next one. This is in a, it appears to be a Catholic church. They're carrying in an idol. Now most of us who grew up Catholic don't realize, don't remember that the statues that you find in the Catholic church are idols. And God hates idols. That's almost biblical. You saw the idol fall and the head fell off the idol. God did that to the Elohim Dagon, the half-man, half-fish God. They brought the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark of God in the Old Testament, into the Temple of Dagon. And Dagon standing there, because they made Dagon like that, stone, wood. They built Dagon, and he's standing against the corner, half-man, half-fish God, that they had to nail to the floor, nail to the wall. When they brought the Ark of the Covenant that represented God, it wasn't God. God wasn't in the box. It just was symbolic of the fact that God is. They brought the Ark of the Covenant into that temple, and the next morning they came in, and the idol, Dagon, was on its face. And they picked up their god, and they nailed their god to the wall, and nailed their god to the floor, and lashed their god to the wall, so that their god wouldn't fall down again. And they left. The next morning they came back, and they walked into the temple of their god, Dagon, where the Ark of the Covenant was still sitting, and they found their god fallen down on the floor with his hands and head cut off. Your God is greater than any God. Your God is greater than the world. Your God is greater than the flesh. Your God is bigger than the devil. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Well, of course. But that's not just a feel-good phrase. God is good. God is great. Look at this next, passage, the idol of the nations, verse 15. The idols, the statues, the idols, whatever they worship that isn't the true God. The idols of the nations are silver, they're gold. I mean, they look precious, they look important. They're made by human hands. I mean, that ought to tell us something, shouldn't it? That a God is made with human hands? A statue that's made with human hands is not going to be able to come through for you. It's not going to be able to think about you. It's not going to be able to hurt with you. The idol of the nations are silver and gold made by human hands. They have mouths, but they can't speak. They have eyes, but they can't see. These idols have ears, but they can't hear. Neither is there breath in their mouths, in their nostrils. 18, those who make them will be like them. What the heck does that mean? Well, the Mormons teach that you will someday be God, just like their gods were at one time human. That's not what God is saying. God is saying those idols that are dead and lifeless and unable to see, unable to hear, unable to speak, the people who built them are going to be just like them, unable to hear, unable to see, unable to speak. How tragic for the people of God to end up in a position like that, where we can't hear God anymore. We can't see the things of God anymore. We can't sense what God is doing in our life anymore. Now, there are times when God withholds that life. There are times that God withholds that sense. Most of the time, it's us. Most of the time, we unplug. Most of the time, we're the ones who make decisions, who go down a path that makes it so that we're just unable to see what God wants us to see. We're unable to sense what God wants us to sense. We're unable to be who God wants us to be. The people who start following idols, and it can be anything, and I'm talking to Christians now. He was talking to unbelievers. But believers can follow idols too, can't we? Yeah. Most of us are not going to follow a statue. Guess who most of us start following? Most of it, not, and that wasn't me. Me was following me. That's not you following me. Guess who I think you probably end up following too often? You. Now, we don't say, oh, God, you know, take a vacation. I'm going to be God for a while. Yeah? This is not that. We just know that God is bigger than a church, and we know God is bigger than our problems, and we know God is bigger than the universe. But we forget that God is bigger than us, and we drag out that throne from a closet somewhere, and we sit on it, and we start calling the shots in our life like we is Adonai. Like we are the mighty one, like we are the boss. The people who start following idols will be like them. Won't be able to see, won't be able to hear, won't be able to speak. And if they're not careful, at some point they won't be able to breathe. And so will all who trust in them. 19, all you Israelites, praise the Lord Adonai. House of Aaron, praise the Lord Adonai. House of Levi, praise the Lord Adonai. You who fear him, praise the Lord Adonai. Praise to the Lord Adonai from Zion, to him who dwells in Jerusalem. Praise Adonai. He's a good God. He's a great God, and he is God. He's greater than anything. He's bigger than anything. So how big is your God? Would you say he's big? I think we would agree, right? God is big. Not big like, oh, big, but greater. Yeah. Is he bigger than your church? Yeah, he's bigger than your church. He's bigger than this church. This is it. And by the way, the church is not the building. It's not the bricks, right? You make up the church. I know there are more people saved in the world than come in here on a Sunday morning. I kind of get that. You know, during my fleeting moments of lucidity, I kind of remember that. But this is the local expression of the body of Christ that meets here. Just like you read the church it met at Corinth, the church it met at Galatia, the church it met at Ephesus, the church it met at the Southwest Church. Those were local expressions of ecclesia, of the called out assembly. We're not just assembled. We're assembled to worship God. We're not just together. We're together to seek him. We're not just together. We're together to turn to him. Yeah, God is bigger than your church. God is bigger than the sum of our parts. But don't lose sight of the fact Jesus didn't die for you alone. He didn't die for your family alone. He didn't die for us alone. God sent Jesus Christ to die for the church. God chose to save the world, win the world for the church. Not this church, the church. So I understand there's a bigger expression. But you don't fit out there. Right now, you fit in here. Where do you plug in? Where do you plug in? God is bigger than your church. God is bigger than your problems. God is bigger than your universe. God is bigger than you. He's good. He's great. He's God. So, are you plugged in? Are you saved? Are you serving? Where do you fit? I'm telling you that the fact that God is good and he's great and he's God is supposed to mean something in our lives. It's not just another sermon. I think he's going to finish on time. I don't see that smiley face. I still see numbers going down. It's not just another topic for a talk. It's to remind you that God is supposed to be something in your life. Now, you know that. The danger is when you find yourself in a position where you have to let him be that place in your life again. You know what that means? That means you dragged out the throne and you're sitting on it, and you will deign. You will condescend, and you will let the Lord be the Lord of your life. Oh, let the Lord be the Lord of your life. He is the Lord of your life. You're just listening or you're not. He is the God of you. He is the boss of you. The question is, does your life reflect that? Does your life show that? You need to make sure that you're saved. You need to make sure that before you step out that doorway of death, that you've given your heart and life to Jesus Christ. Grab a blue book from that column, or from the door. Or if you're watching online, there's a virtual blue book. Take that thing. Read that thing. Know this thing. Believe that God loves you. Know that he died. He sent Jesus Christ to die for your sins. Was buried, rose from the dead. Give your heart and life to Jesus Christ. Don't sprinkle a little Jesus on your life. Give your heart and life to him. Get saved. And then be obedient. Be obedient in the most obvious things. If you're not obedient in the most obvious things, you have no right to let anyone follow you. You have no right to say, follow me even as I follow Christ, the way the Apostle Paul did. If you're not in a position where you're obeying God in the simple things, who are we? We're God. Good to meet you. I'm Tone. I'm not. You can't be God. There's only room for one God. He's already there. Obey him. Get saved. Get soaked. Get serious about living for Jesus. It all belongs to him. It's all because of him. Is our life reflecting that? Lord Jesus, help us live for him. Help us get into you. Help us live for you. Help us realize that there is not one event in our lives. There is not one amount of joy. There is not one speck of trial. There is no amount of pressure, no amount of pleasure in our lives that isn't touched by you. God, you know. You know. And you want us to stay on your path. Help us follow you. Help us realize that you are a greater God than any other God. You are a good God. You are the only God. God, we realize it. We remember it. Help us reflect that with every decision we make. In your name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys. Hang around for a while if you can.